God. Praise God. Let the people of God say amen. Amen. I welcome you to The Bread Broadcast, a Bible teaching program from Eternal Food Evangelistic Organization. We are with edify, we exalt, and challenge believers to the Great Commission. Here, we also call sinners to repentance through the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you for joining us. Today, we are going to be talking about winning your war. Winning your war, and the case study is none other than the best, the only example, Jesus Christ. And your short reading is Matthew chapter 4. We start from verse 1 and you stop at 10. That's your homework for this week. Matthew chapter 4, verse 1 to verse 10. But before we start to unpack, let us pray. Father, we thank you. Dear Lord, sweet Jesus, we praise you. Sweet, blessed Holy Spirit, hallowed be your holy name. Father, we have come to hear what you have to say to us again. Oh Lord, let your light penetrate our hearts and let the seed of your word be sown into our hearts on a good soil. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Our foundation text is Ephesians, the epistle to the Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12, we stop at 13. A Bible student knows that verse already. Ephesians 6, 12, from verse 12 to 13. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. The devil would like you to think that your battle, the battle of your life, the fight that you are in is anything but spiritual. But you know what? The primary and the cardinal battle in life is first and foremost spiritual. It doesn't matter if you're a believer or a non-believer, every battle has its root in the spirit realm. Your spiritual loss or win will decide how the other fights that you face in your life, how they turn out to be. So, how do you win your war? Number one, you have to be following Jesus, who is a case study. And by the way, your short reading is based on the temptation of Jesus Christ when he went into the wilderness by the hand of the Holy Spirit and he fasted 40 days and 40 nights and was tempted by the devil. So after the fasting, the devil came to tempt him. And Jesus had to fight his own war against the adversary before he commenced his public ministry. Listen. If you are a Bible-believing, blood-washed, heaven-bound Christian, I'm not talking about baptized pagans. No, I'm talking about a child of God who has the Holy Spirit in his or her heart, that you have been crucified with Jesus. You will go through your own spiritual war. I will go through my own spiritual war before the groundbreaking of anything worthwhile in our lives. Before anything of worth can commence, we have to go through spiritual battle. It's the way it works in the spiritual realm. The life of Jesus has modeled to us what our spiritual walk of faith will look like. If you want to know how your Christian life should be or will be, just read the Gospels from Matthew to Luke to Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. Just look at the life of Jesus. Everything Jesus went through, we are going to go through as believers. Some, apparently, we are not going to go through them literally, like the crucifixion. No. But in a figurative sense, we are going to go through that. Because as a believer, you have to crucify the flesh because you have died with Jesus, you see. So the life of Jesus has modeled and is modeling to us how our spiritual walk ought to look like. Jesus, in complete submission to God the Father, followed the word of God by using it to destroy the attack of the devil. A believer who fails to let God lead, listen up, in any area of their life or in any endeavor they're about to undertake. You want to start a business, you want to go into a relationship with somebody, and oh yeah, he's a Christian, she's a Christian, and you did not even take your time to go on your knees seeking the face of God. You took it into your own hands, thinking you are too smart to decide on your own. Listen up. If you are a Christian like that, you have become spiritually leaderless. You are leading yourself. And nobody leads themselves and says they have a leader. No, you don't have a leader. So if you are taking spiritual decisions into your own hands, thinking you are too smart, you don't have a leader in that area of your life. Some of you, your problem is money. You are okay with the Holy Spirit leading you in every area of your lives, but when it comes to money, Holy Spirit, thank you very much. I got this. You don't got nothing. You have not got anything. You've got to let the Holy Spirit lead you in everything. That is what it means to be a Christian, including how you spend your money and what you spend your money on, you see. But if you don't let the Holy Spirit lead you, listen up. Like someone in a free fall, the result will be bad for you. When you run into the devil along your journey, it's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when. You are definitely going to run into the devil. If you're a Christian, the same thing with me. Proverbs 14:14 says, the backslider, that is a Christian who refuses to let the Holy Spirit lead them in some or any area of their lives, is a backslider in that aspect, ipso facto, of their lives, by the very act, in that area of their lives, is a backslider, because you are not letting the Lord lead. The Bible says you will pay for your behavior, but a good man, not as in doing good works, no. But when you let the Holy Spirit lead you, when you are obedient, God says that is good. But a good man or a good woman will be rewarded for his deeds. You see, that's what the Bible says. Now, if you're a non-believer, you don't believe in Jesus, or you go to church, but you know in your heart that you're a phony, listen up. You are already following the devil. Oh, yeah. You are following the devil. Oh, yeah. And the devil doesn't need to fight you. No. However, you are living in a continuous, frustrated life all the time. because of life's instability. You see, it's a yo-yo life. Today, everything's hunky-dory. It's perfect. Tomorrow, you are tearing your hair out. Why? Because things around you are giving way. You see, your life is not stable because Jesus is not in your life, or Jesus is not in your heart, even though you claim to be a Christian. If you are somebody like that, you are in danger of being killed at any time. Oh yeah, by the devil. A sinner, and I'm using the word a sinner in the context of the Bible, if you go to church and you have been baptized, but your life has not changed, you are still a sinner. You are just a baptized sinner, a baptized pagan, which is, you have no place in the kingdom of God. But that can change. A sinner has no assurance of natural life, and certainly no eternal life. You see, if you are a born-again child of God, nothing, even something bad, cannot come to you without God allowing it. But that's not so for a sinner or a baptized pagan. You are open to the attack of the devil anytime. Proverbs 29 verse 1. He or she that being often reproved and hardens his neck shall suddenly be destroyed, and that without remedy. A fallen believer has Jesus as their captain, the Bible as their constitution, and holiness as their calling. If your Christianity is not according to that bread on the go I just said, you are not a Christian. But you can become a Christian today. A following believer has Jesus as their captain, the Bible as their constitution, and holiness as their calling. Moving on. To win your war, you have to be faithful. The Lord's motive was tempted when Satan asked him to throw himself down from the top of the temple. You see, it didn't take Jesus to the top of a mosque. It didn't take Jesus to the pinnacle of a city hall, to the top of the temple. What is that telling you? Your motive for whatever you claim to do for God. Temple is where we serve God. Your motive for whatever you claim to do for God or on behalf of God will be tested. Motive links directly to the human, watch this, ego. You see, the human ego, that's our motive. It's easy to compromise when motive is wrapped up in self-interest. Jesus' response showed his motive was all about keeping the Father's interest. So he did not compromise his faithfulness to God's interest, which is, thou shalt not tempt the Lord your God. That's what he said to the devil, you see. He said no. The Father, God the Father, has already said, thou shalt not tempt me. He said that in the book of Deuteronomy, you see. God wants uncompromising people who cannot be bought or sold. If at the threat of losing a love relationship or friendship relationship, you turn your back on Jesus and you think you will win your war, you have another thing coming to you. At the threat of losing your job, if you don't lie for your boss, you compromise, and you think you are going to win your war, you must be kidding yourself. God is looking for uncompromising believers. God can only use devoted individuals concerning his plan that the gospel of the kingdom be preached in all the world as a witness to all the nations. That's what he said in the Gospel of Matthew. Before the end comes, it takes courage to be a Christian in a world full of cesspool of sin that we have now. So if you are a compromiser and you are saying, God, how come all this stuff are happening? I pray, I tithe, I do stuff in the church, I help people. The problem is not God. The problem is you. If you are not stable, you cannot win your war. No. Because we're on a battlefield. Flaky people usually turn out to be sleazy people. Oh yeah. They will tell you something in your presence and they walk away. They do something different. They are politicians, you see. You cannot just take their word for it. God says, ha ha ha. If you are like that, I can't trust you. You can be bought or sold. You can compromise at the drop of a hat. Listen, you have to do some extra work on yourself. When you are ready, I can help you. But if you want to continue playing games, I don't have time. That's God for you. He's serious. He's ready to do business with people who are serious with the business of souls, you see. Proverbs 29:15, Proverbs chapter 29, verse 15. Confidence in an unfaithful man in time of trouble is like a broken tooth and a foot out of joint. If you have had a broken tooth before, and I've had one, oh my, it's not funny. God said, if you cannot be trusted, if you are not faithful, if you can compromise your faith just like that, he said you are like a broken tooth and a foot out of joint. You see, to lack spiritual integrity is to be passed over in times of spiritual duty. Listen, if you cannot be faithful to the faith, don't blame God. If you are not winning your war, you are your own problem, not God. God is always faithful. To lack spiritual integrity is to be passed over in times of spiritual duty. Nobody who is a compromiser can have spiritual integrity. Moving on. You have to be fervent. So if you want to win your war, not only are you to be a following believer, not only are you to be a faithful believer, you also need to be a fervent believer. Jesus showed fervency in everything he did, ministering to many people during the day or a single person at night. Jesus was never idle, no. Also, every disciple that Jesus called was doing something. Peter and his brother were fishing. Philip and Andrew, I believe, they were with John the Baptist, helping him at the Jordan. Nathanael was under the fig tree, meditating. You see, they were all doing something. Matthew, Levi, his name was Levi, but it was later changed to Matthew. He was a tax collector collecting taxes. When Jesus saw him, you see, all the disciples that Jesus called, they were busy doing something. When he called them, listen up. God does not delight in lazy people. Oh, no, no, no. He said a lazy man, the Bible says a lazy man is a brother to a destroyer, you see. If you're a lazy person, God looks at you and says, you are a brother to a destroyer, you see. When someone is not faithful, they may not be lazy, but they are flaky. But here, when you are not fervent, you are lazy. You may be faithful, but if you are lazy, you are still a brother or a sister to a destroyer. If you are only battle ready, you are only ready to comply or to work for God or be passionate for God when it is convenient or comfortable for you, you cannot win your war. Forget it. God often, listen up, track with me. God often calls people to assignment. Are you ready for this? When it looks naturally illogical. Those who love you, I'm telling you, if they tell you to your face, this is stupid. Don't be angry with them. Honestly, they are saying it out of concern because it's going to look irrational. Maybe you are just being promoted at work and God is calling you to leave that job for something else. Those who love you will say, hey, listen, buddy, something is going on. See the doctor. They are not being rude, honestly. But if you know God has called you to do this, you just smile and say, don't worry about it. You see. Because God will not call you when it looks convenient. No. And he will not call you to come and do something that you can easily do. No, he will call you when it looks naturally illogical to do almost impossible tasks. To tell God you will answer his call when everything is ready to your satisfaction is to miss out on God's best plan. It's a shame. Time will not allow me to give examples of people I know that they missed out on their moment of visitation because they're saying, God, when I finish paying for my house, when I finish paying for my car, when I finish this, and boom, God will go on to another person and choose a different vessel to do his job, you see. A lazy or lackadaisical person will be a liability to God because you know why? The world is on a borrowed time before the day of judgment of God. According to Obadiah chapter 1 verse 15, we are not going to read that. He says, the day of the Lord is near against all heathens. So God wants to save as many people as possible. So God has no time to waste. The world is on a collision course with the judgment of God, you see. So God cannot use lazy people. Oh no. Similarly, God is looking for soldiers to train, knowing that the devil, our enemy, can and does attack unexpectedly. Let's go to 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8. 1 Peter 5, 8. Be sober, be vigilant. Because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. To be found available is to be found reliable. To be found reliable is to be found usable. Let me say that again slowly. To be found available is to be found reliable. To be found reliable by God is to be found usable for God. Now, to be a following, faithful, and fervent believer, what happens? What do you experience? Is to experience God's favor. And I love this definition of the favor of God from God's Questions. It's beautiful. It says, the favor of God can be described as, quote, tangible evidence that a person has the approval of the Lord, you see, end of quote. The favor of God is not for you, is not you driving Mercedes. No. The favor of God is not you having a $500,000 home. No. The favor of God is not you having a $150,000 per annum job. No. The favor of God is to have the approval of God in your life. This is the supernatural component of winning your battle. This can only come from God. The presence of God was with Jesus in spirit and power. And everywhere Jesus went, He was able to fulfill God's agenda. Why? Because the Bible says, for God was with him. The same thing was said of Joseph, for God was with Joseph, you see. If we want to fulfill God's plan for our lives by winning the war of our lives, we cannot live like the devil and expect heaven, and when I say heaven, I'm saying God, to support us. It's impossible. It's a holy God. When we align with God's principles, his favor is bound to come upon us. He has promised. Let's look to Proverbs chapter 12, verse 2. And I'm reading from the Contemporary English Version. I like the way it's said here. Proverbs 12, 2. The Lord likes, King James says, favors everyone who lives right, but he punishes everyone who makes evil or wicked plans, you see. He will only favor those who live right. If you don't live right, the favor of God is not going to come upon you. Oh no, forget it. There is no celebration of God's goodness without separation unto God's holiness. Let me back up and say that very slowly. Because we have all kinds of mumbo-jumbo Christians and Christianity now. People fornicating all over the place, calling themselves Christians. The devil is a liar. There is no celebration of God's goodness without separation unto God's holiness. So what have we done so far? How can we win our war? And remember, your spiritual war determines your natural wars. We have to be followed. This is to let the Holy Spirit be the captain in all areas of our lives. We have to be faithful. This is to let God's interest be our motive in all things. We have to be fervent. This is to be ready to obey God when it's not convenient. Now, to be a following, faithful, and fervent believer, we bring God's favor. This is the blessing we receive, having shown ourselves obedient and reliable. Are you a believer? Huh? Crucified to the world, to sin, to self, and alive to Jesus Christ and holiness. Are you? Then if you are, where are you losing your war as a disciple of Jesus? Where? Have a spiritual checkup and let the Holy Spirit reveal the truth to you and then make corrections. 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 3, we are not going to read that, says, we have been born again unto a living hope. That is victory. We are not born again to be a victim of the devil, oh no. Or the victim of sin, oh no. Or the victim of the world system, no. We have been born again unto a living hope, a life of victory in Jesus, amen. Are you unsaved, you're a pagan, or you are a pagan Christian? You have been living a defeated life all along. Am I lying? Be honest with yourself for once. Listen, the devil hates you. The devil hates me. The devil hates everybody. Mohammedan, Buddhist, it doesn't. The devil hates everybody. However, for an unbeliever who does not have Jesus in their heart, you don't know that the devil hates you because he's giving you fake pleasures as he's destroying you, you see. The devil is destroying your life piecemeal and you're smiling. That's the devil for you. If you give your life to Jesus today, he will save you from sin, from Satan, from the world system. Equip you and help you win your wars in life. And when you die, this is the best part. Jesus will take you to heaven to live with him forever. Just as I have that hope. Now, if you are ready to take this offer, incredible offer from God, a link is coming out. Follow that link. We can only do so much on this program. Okay? But we will meet you there. Let us pray. Father, your word has gone out. I pray, dear Lord Jesus, that you use the word as you use the stone that came out of David's sling to destroy the Goliath of Satan, sin, and self in the lives of all the hearers. And Lord, I pray for myself too. In those areas where I need to brush up, that you will help me too. That Lord, holiness unto the Lord will be our watchword. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. I will see you next week, only if Jesus has not split the sky open.